Christmas Grounded Community Church. Can you please greet the person next to you Merry Christmas before we start singing? Merry Christmas. The Lord is good and He is with us, so let's all stand up and let's sing together.
See you.
celebrate, O God, your goodness, O God, and your greatest gift, your Son, Jesus Christ. For in Isaiah 9, 6 to 7, it says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace." For this morning, we bless you, we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap. You may all be seated.
Again, thank you for coming today here at Grounded Community Church. This Sunday, actually, is traditionally being celebrated, especially for Filipinos, is we call it the Bispiras ng Pasko, is the day or the night before Christmas. And usually, this is one of the most attended Sunday gathering that we usually have. But we thank you for coming in this morning. If you see, we had set up differently. We usually don't set up our place like this. For those of you who don't know, we had our Christmas program last Sunday, The Sounds of Christmas. And we had set up the sanctuary like this with food and everything. And it was really good for people to sit down and actually have fellowship. So we had thought, since it's the day before Christmas anyway, Bispiras ng Pasko, why don't we leave it like that and we'll continue with the fellowship. So today again, that's why we had left it like this, and we will have food served for you again after the service. So we will continue with the fellowship today, okay? For those of you who just came, our guests, we thank you for coming in here at Ground Community Church. Next Sunday is our last Sunday of the year, and we will be actually meeting the new year for that. And so we will be having communion next Sunday. I invite you again to come and join us for next Sunday and have communion as we meet the 2024. So after next Sunday, on January 8 to the 13, here at Ground Community Church, we'll have our annual prayer and fasting from January 8 to the 13. Now, anybody is actually invited to join us. If you want to know more about this, come see me or pastor or anybody of our workers here. We can tell you more about it. But it's actually a time of coming before God and seeking Him earnestly to start the new year. So don't forget that, January 8 to the 13 next year. Okay. Our weekly schedule, actually, Mondays we have our prayer meeting. We do it via Zoom. Now, midweek usually have it here, but we wanted actually you to spend more time because I know a lot of people actually are on their vacation. So we will also do this coming midweek at Zoom also. But again, next Sunday, we'd like to see you come back here and celebrate New Year with us as we end 2003 and meet 2024. Okay? So before I call Pastor Marissa, could you join me in praying for the Sunday gathering this morning? Father, we just want to thank you again for this Sunday, especially as we celebrated the day before Christmas of the traditional birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord God, we thank you, Lord, that you had brought him here on earth, oh, Lord God, that we could actually have life, Lord God, eternally because of him. And Lord God, as we traditionally celebrate, we just want to say, happy birthday, Lord Jesus. And Lord God, again, we commit you the rest of the service. We just pray that you be ahead of us, even our fellowship after the service. Lord, be with us in our conversation and bless again the gathering this morning. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Christmas program last week, as we entitled it, The Song of Christmas, or The Sound of Christmas. Reiterating the Monday prayer that Paul mentioned earlier. In fact, we're not going to do a Monday prayer this coming 24th, 25th, and the 1st. It will not be via Zoom. I'm challenging every family to gather your family on the 25th. At 7 in the evening, to go pray together. Can we do that? So your family on Monday gathered together in celebration of the 25th, thanking the Lord for the year 2023. So gather your family on Monday or whatever time you want. But because if you will have a Christmas dinner at 7 or 6, then gather together, pray, thank God for 2023. That's on the 25th. On this January the 1st, which is the next Monday, then gather your family again together and pray and thank God for the new year. And we are thankful that we have another year coming, right? So pray, thank God for the coming 2024, and then pray for what God is going to give and work in your family relationally, financially, emotionally, mentally, physically, individually, and as a family, as God would meet with you on the first day of 2024. Are we closing this year? Next Sunday, as Paul mentioned, we will have our communion. And the question this morning, that because it's the 24th of December, and in Tagalog, it's Bisperas, or the day before the traditional birth of Jesus. So the question would be, how do people react to Christmas? How do people react to it? I know I've been celebrating Christmas with understanding, probably since I was five. So I grew up knowing that Jesus is the Son of God here. But I never knew who Jesus is here, like a personal relationship, because Christianity is not a religion. It is a relationship. There are religions out there that tells you to do this and do that, but Christianity, it is already a relationship to the God that sent his son to die for you and me. That's the reason why, how do people react to Christmas? And I know some of you reacted the same way that I did. I know him here first. Then eventually, I realized that there should be a transfer from the mind to the heart, because it is a relational journey with the Son of God. Let's bow heads for a moment. And our God, we thank you, Father, for the grace that we receive from you every celebration of Christmas. We may have different reasons of celebrating, O God, but one thing is for sure. It is the season that you are celebrated the most. You're the reason for the season, O God. And so, Father, thank you that more than 2,000 years ago, you sent your son Jesus as a babe, Lord, so that he would redeem us, O God, from who we are, from our sins, that we may be forgiven, that we will have eternal life with you, that heaven is our home one day. And so, Father God, today, may we just find ourselves, what reaction do people do when they hear the word Christmas? And so thank you, Father God. We bless you. You alone be honored. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone just say. So what's our reaction to Christmas? I've said, firstly, when we started celebrating Christmas, I just know Jesus here. Period. But I never had a relationship with him that really brought me to a deeper journey and walk with him. So in John 3:16, the Bible said this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one and only son, that whoever, could you read, believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Now, this is the promise of God, that the birth of Jesus is not just for gifts or whatever that we understand Christmas is. It's not just Christmas trees or it's not just decorations. But the reason for the season is this, that God so loved the world. I said this last week. Somebody said that the reason for the season is Jesus. But somebody said this beautifully as well. The reason for the season is you and me. Because God understood that we need his saving grace. That's why he sent a Savior by the name of Jesus. God gave the gift of his one and only Son. And that is what Christmas is all about, where the eternal destiny of each one of us is determined by his response to the gift God gave at Christmas time. And in the passage we are to read today, we find only two responses that is in the Bible. Responses towards Christmas. And we find this in the Gospel of Matthew. So what's the first reaction when you hear or people hear about Christmas season? Well, of course, sadly, the first thing is that we hear rejection. People reject Christmas. In fact, today, over at Utah, I believe, Utah or is it Montana, that in the city hall, it's no longer just the nativity that is on the city hall grounds. It's not just the nativity that is present on the city hall grounds. You know, it was also erected in the city hall grounds, a satanic Christmas tree with the horns, with a goat and with the horn and so on. And the city allowed it because an expression of First Amendment and so on. And one Navy veteran got angry about it. You know what he did? Destroyed that. But of course, they see him as anti so many things. So they reject that. They reject the reason for the season. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 3 to 4, when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ or Messiah was to be born. And if you look at the underlined words, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. And as we think of how Herod refused to accept that there would be another king aside from him, hello, he was saying, I am the king. But then he had this understanding that throughout history, the Israelites were looking forward to a Messiah or a king that would one day be born king of the Jews. So was the problem with Herod? He was disturbed. Herod's problem was found in Matthew chapter 2, verse 3. He was disturbed and all Jerusalem with him. Now, like today, you know what's happening today in America? Law is now being undermined by political pressure, left and right. And if you look at it, for them to have power, they would do all their means to destroy or to eliminate one candidate so that their candidate would win. This is like Herod. I am the king. No one is going to be the king except me. And if you know the background of King Herod, he is a very horrible king. He murdered his wife, murdered his sons and his daughter, so that he would remain king. That's why for him to kill children 2 years down, that is not his relative, it's a piece of cake for him, because his relatives, he doesn't want to be people that would take his crown. That's the reason why he was disturbed. He rejects this king that is here. That is the lie that at the root of all unbelief and rebellion against God, when Satan said, are you sure that you will not be, you will die when you eat of the fruit in the Garden of Eden? And so, the notion that we know better what is best for us than God does, the idea that we can and should be our own God. And this was the first lie that Satan said in the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 5, he said here, for God knows that when you eat of this, Eve said, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So we live in a day today that this notion that we can be our own God is so prevalent. There was a Christian who was talking to a New Ager one time. And the Christian asked, when you die, what will you say to God when he asks you, why should I let you into my heaven? Beautiful question, isn't it? If you are to die today, I'm not saying you will, but if you are, and you expect that you go to heaven, and you are in the pearly gates, and here was Peter, and Peter asked you, why are you coming inside? What is your pass to enter heaven? And Peter calls, God, there's somebody here says he's coming inside to heaven. So what is your answer? The New Ager answered the Christian this way. He responded, I am God, and I would never ask myself that question. Now, if you look at the person beside you, can we be gods? I mean, small g, of course. I can be God of myself, but not capital G. That's why the world rejects Jesus, because they cannot have any other gods aside from them. Herod didn't want to deal with this question either, because I would never ask myself that question, the New Ager said. That's why 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 11 to 12, the Bible said, for this reason, God sends them a powerful, could you read? Delusion, so that they will believe the lie. And so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. Now you're saying, Pastor Mario, shouldn't it be that we should be celebrating, be happy on Christmas time? This is, it's a most wonderful time of the year. Have you agree? Of course it's the most wonderful time of the year. The reason why Jesus was born. It's the most wonderful time of the year. But it differs on how and what you believe. If you think that like the New Ager that you believe you are God, why would I ask myself this question if I go to heaven? But if you know that there is God, and you believe that God will become part of your life as you believe in Him, then truly it's the most wonderful time of the year. Last night I couldn't sleep. And what kept on going through my mind is a song, What Child Is This Who Lay to Rest on Mary's Lap Is Sleeping. You know, I was listening to that song and I was saying, God Almighty, why would this God come down, become human? Not because He wants to, but because He loves to. There's a big difference, because you and I are loved by God in spite of who we are. You know, sometimes when we love somebody, there's a condition attached to it, isn't it? There's a condition attached to it if we love someone. Like, I love you if, I love you when, I love you not, I love you, just something attached to it. Herod's problem, he doesn't want to have any other king except him. The second, of course, is that Herod's deception. And we find this again and again and again today too. We're deceived by people about what Christmas is and what it is to be celebrated about. In Matthew chapter 7, 2, verse 7 to 8, the Bible said, Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and make a careful search for the child. And you seem to think that he is really wanting to find out who this child is so that he would celebrate with them. And he said, And as you find him, report to me so that I may too go and worship him. But that was his deception. Herod made the pretense that he wanted to worship Christ, but that was not the case at all. Instead, Herod was trying to work his situation to his advantage, to that which would benefit him to be king forever until he dies. Like not being dethroned as the king of the Jews, but remain to be in power. And we see that today, even in our political arena. Herod wanted to secretly arrange for the murder of Jesus. That's why he had secretly asked the wise men when they had observed the star. And he wanted to determine how old the child was that he wanted to murder. And for you who have read the Bible, you know this happened. So Herod mistakenly thought that he could thwart God's purpose in the birth of the Messiah. One other point needs to be made about the reaction of Herod. Herod's rejection was one of antagonism. But he wasn't the only one guilty of rejecting the Messiah. The religious leaders also rejected the gift of God's Son. Their rejection was not antagonistic, but apathetic. Today, we have nothing wrong with what men choose to have. If you choose to be who you want to be, I have no problem with that. Except until you create chaos towards me. If you force me to do what you are doing, then the line stops here. Because I know I've been called by God to talk about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. A lady called the pastor one time because the church was mailing out invitations like what we did last week. And the lady called the pastor and said, "Why did you send me a mail?" And he said, "What mail? This literature about the Sunday gathering here and so on. Don't change my religion." You know, we think that when we send, invite you, we are changing your religion. We are not. We're opening your eyes to what is true. And once you know the truth, and you'll compare to where and what religion you are believing, and you will see the difference. And when you see the difference, you say, "What gives? You know, this is what I heard, and this is what they're teaching me. This is not in the Bible. This is what's the Bible." And then you find the perspective in saying, "This is real, because the truth sets people free." And that's what happened to us too. We were brought in a religion that has so many traditions, so many traditions. We have to do this, we have to do that. The question is, what is the standard that we have done enough? Ask yourself, what is the standard that we have done enough that God would say, "You're heaven bound"? What's your measuring rod? The person sitting beside you? If that's just the person beside you, then we all fall short. Because the standard is God's. And so the pastor said, "I am not changing your religion. I'm just sharing the word of God that your eyes may be opened. And it's your choice to believe it or not." So when we were growing up, there's a movie that we watch. We were about probably 16 or 17. A movie called The Exorcist. How many watch it? Right? Scary movie. About 8 or 9 of us went down to Session Theater in Baguio, go down the stairs. As we were going down, we heard the movie watchers laughing. And we were saying to the 9 of us, "Isn't it Exorcist? Why are all there laughing?" So as we opened the doors, the door opened and the light shone on them. They were laughing like this. They were a laughter of fear. And so we said, "Oh," we went inside, watched it. That night, all of us couldn't sleep. We couldn't sleep. I stood up, turned on the light, and my mom said, "Why did you turn on the light?" Nothing. The next Sunday, the 9 of us went to church in our old faith. We were at the balcony. We were all at the front of the balcony. We were so intently listening to what the priest was saying. But after that, 3 Sundays later, we're not back to church. We're back playing again. Because it is all here. And then one day, a missionary came, taught the Bible, taught the truth. And we said, "We're missing a lot." And then I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ when my teacher in sociology said, "If you want to be Christian with me this day, pray this prayer with me." And I prayed with her. And I could sense something move in me. I could sense something like a warm touch overcoming me. So I went home. As I went home, I didn't felt like walking. I got home. When I got home, I asked my wife, "Ma, do you have a Bible with you?" think about this. Of all the things I'm going to ask my wife, Ma, do you have a Bible with you? And she said, yes. And she took the white New Testament Bible. Why? Because when she was capped as a nurse, they gave her that Bible. I opened that Bible, and I started to read, and I never stopped reading since then. Because John said, unless you're born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And I became a Christian, and I never looked back. God became alive. And what's the reaction to Christmas? You may reject Jesus Christ. We may deceive ourselves who Jesus is because we are apathetic, we are antagonistic about it. Because Matthew chapter 2, verse 3, the Bible said there, when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. This teaches us a lesson about rejecting Jesus Christ. To not to receive him is to reject Christ. And we cannot ride any fence that we want to build, whether we love him or we hate him. There's no middle ground. That's why in John 3:18, whoever believes in him is not condemned, the Bible said. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. And here, in the story of Christmas, there were two young people spoken to by the angel Gabriel, Mary and Joseph. They were spoken to, and they were just young teenagers wanting to live their life the way that they were, oh, like their peers during that time. But then one night, Mary heard the dream. God had a dream. And the angel Gabriel told her that she would become the mother of God's Son. And when Joseph wanted to divorce Mary because that's the right thing to do, because how could a virgin become pregnant? Guess what? Joseph heard Gabriel too. And God spoke to Mary and Joseph through the angel Gabriel and told them the most beautiful thing that's going to happen to them. Can they make this work?
Change, thinking the best of this might be the only way. Can we to believe.
Our future holds more than what we can see. We have to trust what we don't understand. It could be a part of God's plan.
Can we make this work? I don't try.
That's a question. Can we make this work? But we have to trust in God's plan. It was Mary and Joseph. They were teenagers, just like Van and Rico. Not older than they are. They're younger, in fact, according to Scripture. And so that's all we're saying. Sometimes we don't understand God's plan. In fact, we will not understand God's plan until we look back and see what happened, and eventually we understand the plans of God. The first reaction was rejection, but then the Bible said there is the second reaction to Christmas, and we say this: reception. That we receive the Son of God as who He is. Whether he was born a babe, whether he was born as king, he is the Son of God to redeem us from our sins. That's why in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 and 2, the Bible said, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Judea, during the time of King Herod, magi, or traditionally wise men from the east, came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw a star in the east, or star rose, and have come to worship him. And here, there are two things that the reception of the Magi reflects to those who came to understand that Jesus is the reason for the season. The very first one, of course, is their passion. You know, I have met people through my years of missions and being pastor. I've met people that are hard-hearted. That you cannot paint their face because of their darkened hearts. You know, that they can kill you with their stares. But when they met the Lord Jesus Christ, the living Messiah, you could see that you can paint their face because it has become so beautifully done by God. You know, the light shines. And their attitude changed. And they become more lovable, more compassionate. I was one of them. There's a reason why I can talk about the mercies of God. Because if God has not been merciful to me, has not been so gracious, compassionate to me, and forgiving, I won't be here today. Because the one that was king of the Jews met me one day. And it will happen to you too, for those who have not accepted who Jesus is. The reason why their passion, the Magi, Myron Osberger said this: it is believed that the Magi came from Persia and were a tribe of priests. Herodotus says they were originally a tribe of Medes who became a priestly tribe, much like the Levites of Israel. They became lead teachers of Persian kings and were skilled in philosophy and science. And guess what? They were Persians, but they went to look for the king of their enemy, the Jews. Think about that. The king of the Jews. What would they care? They're Persians. They were the kingdom then. They were the people then that they have subdued even Israel during their time, their greatness during the time. But then they realize, as the star of Jesus arose, as they've studied the stars, God spoke to them that His Son is to be born in Bethlehem during their time. Something spectacular appeared in the heavens, and they felt that God was breaking into the natural order and announcing some special event. And the wise men, seeing the star, were convinced of an act of God in which the entry of a great king was being heralded to the world. There was a general expectation at the time of an imminent messianic announcement. This is found in the writings of Josephus, the writings of the wise men in the Middle East and in Greece, and in the writings of Roman historians, that indeed there is a messianic king to be born. At the time that Jesus was born, there was general expectation that God would bring a person into the world, could you read, who would deliver man from his bondage and his limitations. And apparently the wise men took some length of time after the birth of Christ to arrive in Bethlehem. And their passion drove them and drove them to stay on course to really look for the Son of God. It may have been all of 2 years. 2 years that they have traveled to look for that Messiah where the star would settle. Until they actually arrived and found the young child Jesus, no longer the baby, but a child, which explains why Herod sought to kill all the male children 2 years and under. And so in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, on the morning, on coming to the house, they saw the child, not the baby anymore. The child, meaning time has elapsed when Jesus was born, when the Magi saw him. In fact, 2 years that they have passionately searched for the king of their enemy, the king of the Jews. And they saw the child with his Mary, Mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. In verse 11, we read that when they have come to the house, the young child was there. Finding them in a house, and the reference to a young child rather than to a babe are further indications of the elapsed time from the birth of Christ until the occasion when the wise men arrive. And all this speaks to their passion. You know the reason why Sunday after Sunday, you would find volunteers here preparing this, preparing something for the food that we will eat afterwards, practicing, perfecting their craft. There are people at the back that you don't see, our tech guys. They're doing it so that they would express their love for God. There are those who are volunteers in the children's ministry. In fact, one volunteer here, she was teaching one class with her daughter beside her. And every time that she would teach the other children, the daughter would grab her hand and says, "You're my mother, okay? Don't forget, you're my mother." And she's volunteering. One child asked a volunteer, if Jesus was fully God and fully man, he couldn't be 100%, because if fully God and fully man, he's 50% man, 50% God. So Can it be 100% or 200%? What's your answer? But they passionately continue to do so because they know they have the answer, and that is God. Not everything in the Bible we will know eventually, because if we know the Bible like the back of our hands and memorize it and know the meaning of it every time that we read it, then we don't need God. That way somebody asked, what's more important, the Bible or prayer? You know the answer to that? Both. And the parallel example of the one that answered it said, it's like inhaling and exhaling. When you read, you are inhaling the Word of God. When you pray, you are exhaling, talking to God. Because if you just inhale and not exhale, you die. If you exhale and don't inhale, you die. The same thing. So what is their purpose? In Matthew chapter 2, verse 10 to 11, the Bible said, when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary's mother and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Master Kaido said, worship is the thank you that refuses to be silenced. And I love that. Michael Card said this, all we could ever imagine, could ever hope for, he is. He is the Prince of Peace whose first coming has already transformed society, but whose second coming will forever establish justice and righteousness. All this and infinitely more, alive in an impoverished baby in a barn. That is what Christmas means. To find a place where you would least expect to find anything you want. Everything you could ever want. Everything that you could ever want. That's what the Magi found when they found the Christ. And that's what we find when we find the Christ today. And they gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And because of this, they honored Jesus. You know, the Magi's gift honored Jesus in three things. Number one, his sovereignty. That's gold. Sovereignty, because he is king, and they gave him gold. When the Magi presented gold, they honored Jesus with the very best that they possessed, and they recognized that Jesus was king. Gold was often paid in tribute to a king, and this is what the wise men did. They paid tribute to Christ as king. Gold, his sovereignty. Second, his sacrifice. Frankincense, because he was sacrificed at the cross for you and me. And frankincense is a very costly and fragrant gum that is distilled from a tree that is found in Persia, India, and Arabia, as well as the East Indies. The word actually means whiteness, referring to the white colored juice which flows out of the wound in the tree when they scar it and scar it. And scarred. That's the same thing that they did to the back of Jesus when he was sacrificed for you and me. It was given for that whiteness. It was given 3 months to harden. Then it is sold in clumps of resin. It was highly fragrant when burned and was therefore used in worship. It was also used as a medicine and as a perfume, frankincense. Sovereignty, sacrifice, and the third gift is suffering. And it's called myrrh. He suffered for you and me. He didn't need to. He could come down here as totally, fully king. But he came as a baby. so that he would understand. We would understand that he had to go through life the way that we did, so we have an excuse. He felt what we feel. That's why myrrh is an aromatic gum produced from a bush that grew in Arabia and Ethiopia, and was obtained in the same ways that this frankincense, they would crush it. When it oozes from the wound shrub, myrrh is yellow at first. But as it hardens, guess what? It changes to dark red, like the blood of Jesus that was spilled on the cross. While frankincense represents sweetness, myrrh represents bitterness, at least to the taste. Because when God saw his son crucified, lying on the cross, it was bitter to him that heaven was silent. And the heavens became dark. And that was the only time that God turned away from his son, because Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because all the sins of humanity was laid on him. The sins of yesterday, the sins of today, the sins of tomorrow. That's why we have forgiveness. When God forgives us, we are forgiven completely. Such was the wise men's perspective concerning the one they had come to honor. They acknowledged that he was the King of Kings, come to earth to suffer and offer himself as a sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the world. No wonder they bowed before him. Likewise, as we consider the fact that Christ was born to die, that he came to the cradle so he might come to the cross, you and I should likewise bow our knees and hearts to him. As the Magi brought honor to Jesus and often cited, then you and I too, when we focus our worship to the reason for the season, we honor him too. Don't let the strong winds of Christmas activity cause one to miss the breath or the beacon of the star that shone over Bethlehem to announce that which was God was doing that would forever change the world. To look to that star and understand its message could forever change one's life. You know, the next gentleman is going to sing the song. I wasn't able to introduce him last week, but we asked him to sing the song again that he sung, called Edelweiss. When I got to know this guy, his life was not the way that he is today. In fact, he said, Pastor Mario, I was a crazy guy too. I lived my life through the drugs and so on and so many things that I think my brain has been burned by all the things that I've ingested. That when you teach, I couldn't get it. It couldn't connect with me. I couldn't understand what you're saying. But he kept on, and he kept on, and he kept on. Every chance that he gets, he kept on listening and joining the small group, the life group, and kept on learning, kept on studying. I made a testimony last Thursday, and he said, Pastor Mario, today I connect with what you're saying. Now everything seems clear to me. That's why when I told him to sing Edelweiss, he was glad to sing it. He's not the perfect singer, but he sing it with his passion because it has a purpose to honor the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. By the way, we welcome God through this man. Let's give the hand, big hand to God through Martin.
Thank you.
to me. Blossom of snow made you blue and grow. Bloom and grow forever. Head of ice, head of ice, bless my home now forever. Jesus Christ, Son of God, every morning you greet me. Lord of life, my heart's delight, you're so happy to meet me. My blossoming faith made it grow and glow, glow and go forever. Love of my life, Jesus Christ, guide my journey forever. My blossoming faith made it grow and glow, glow and go forever. Love of my life, Jesus Christ, guide my journey forever. Guide my journey forever.
Jesus Christ, love of my life, guide my journey forever. Let's all stand. I close with Luke chapter 2, verse 8 to 14. The Bible said, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." Let's bow our heads for a moment. Where you are standing this morning, as we have heard the words today, as we've listened to the song, as you've seen the passion of those who are saying, "Jesus Christ, love of my life," may you find yourself too this morning to have that in your hearts. Because we only live once. Death would come. Anytime that day, we do not know. Only God knows. The question would be, where would you go? Would it be heaven, where is eternal life, or would it be hell, eternal damnation? Christmas came so that we will be saved. We may be redeemed from who we are. Because Christ said, it is finished, when he died on the cross, that the path to eternity is ready set because he has come. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you want to know and be certain and be assured that heaven will be your home, pray this prayer with me. As the Bible said, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, you will be saved. So pray this prayer with me. Father God in heaven, thank you for Jesus who died on the cross for my sin. I accept, Lord, his sacrifice. I believe that I am forgiven, that you accept me as your child today and washed my sins, washed white as snow. Thank you that you would journey with me until life is taken from me here. This I pray in Jesus' name. Almighty God, I pray, Father God, for those who pray this prayer. Father God, may it be real to them, O God, that a journey of faith begins now, that they would find the truth continually, Father God, and grow in that truth, that, Lord, the blossoming faith would grow and glow, glow and go forever, because of your great love over them and over us as your people. Thank you. We love you, O God. Be with every family that's going to celebrate, Father God, the Noche Buena tonight. And Lord, even Father God, Lord, for the prayer, family prayer tomorrow on the 25th of December. Lord, that we would thank you for 2023 and your goodness and the challenges that we have overcome and everything that made us as who we are today. Thank you. We thank you, Father God, for your faithfulness and your grace. We thank you for your, Lord, unending grace and unending love. Thank you. Lord, as you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to us, we give our tithes, our offerings with grateful hearts, that you alone, Lord God, will move this work forward because of that. Thank you. We love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone just say, amen and amen and amen. Father God, we bless you. You may be seated for some announcements. Amen.
Again, our service is formally ended. We haven't actually ended yet. So we do have some food prepared for you. But to do that in orderly fashion, let me ask again that the tables at the back would start going in first after we sing our closing prayer. And as you see the line getting shorter, I may ask the ushers to please start guiding people to get in line again for that. Again, we thank you for joining us today. We hope to see you next Sunday for our communion service to end the year 2003 in mid-2024. Again, Merry Christmas, everyone. Have a safe Merry Christmas, and then we hope to see you again back here. Maraming salamat po and God bless.
Stand up and join us as we sing the song.